What's going on, guys? It's Bronwyn from Empire Barbell. I'm back, and today we're going to talk about some movement variations. It's no secret that I'm a minimalist. I like to use the main competitive compound movements as the big driving force of progress. It just makes good sense. It has this 1-2 punch where you get extra work practicing the thing you are going to do in competition, which is important from a specificity angle. But these movements are also fantastic developmental tools. There isn't a big reason to swap them out or run endless variations. Squatting, pressing, pulling, rowing, these were all movements that were developmental tools before powerlifting even existed. So really not going to do a lot better than them in terms of bang for your buck. So that's why I like to emphasize those. Now, there's different degrees of specificity. I'm not going to recommend you spend your entire life just doing those movements. Of course, we want to build our base. We want to round ourselves out. We want a certain amount of variety to prevent stagnation from setting in, but also to kind of round out weak areas. And we don't want to wait for weakness to develop. We want enough variety that we can actually prevent weaknesses from developing. Now, the thing is, because again, I'm a minimalist, and I always go towards the simplest explanation unless we need more complexity to solve a specific problem. But many of you will favor really exotic accessory work or really exotic exercise variations that rely on some unique specialty bar that is super expensive or some impossible to reproduce conformation of bands and chains or some weird movement that's kind of not seen very often and really hard to execute and dial in. So I like to eliminate all of the pitfalls that come with that and start with the simple stuff. If you are still in the realm where you're trying to just build a generally well-rounded physique and you're still doing a lot of main work on the compound list to try and build technique in that, then changes and variations should meet this threshold of simplicity where they're easy to implement, easy to reproduce, and easy to chart so you know exactly how it's working for you. The easiest, simplest way, and probably the way that many of you are skipping in terms of things that are unnecessarily advanced, is just to vary your grip or vary your stance. Same movement with a bench or an overhead press, just taking your hands wider or more narrow. With a squat or deadlift, taking your feet wider or more narrow. And that gives a ton of variation. It gives this huge surge in adaptation because it seems small, but it is actually, I mean, you're talking about being worked through different angles. You're requiring a completely different motor pattern to be executed. You have to recruit different motor units. So it's a different neurological effect. You'll notice that you have to brace differently. You'll notice that the point of purchase, where you feel your strength come from, is completely different. And it's going to allow you to grow in a way that will kind of pad your body. It'll increase your margin for error, it'll pad your lifts, and it can actually, you know, fix or even prevent weaknesses. So that's what we're gonna go over. So narrow variations are always going to disadvantage, meaning the joint has to work harder, so the muscle that moves that joint has to work harder, so it stands to reason it would grow more. The distal joint, God, I hope I'm using that right, the joint that is furthest away from your body. So in a bench press, your shoulders and elbows move, a closer grip bench press is going to work the elbow joint more. It's more disadvantaged. It has to go through more motion. Your tricep is the main extensor of your elbow. So your tricep takes a hit on close grip presses. I love close grip presses. Most of my pressing is actually close grip. I actually do most of my pressing about right in here because I find it carries over to overhead better and it keeps my triceps growing because I don't really bench competitively. But I find that it's a lot easier on the shoulders. I find that it's great tricep developmental work, and I find that when I do it for a long time and I go back to a regular bench press, I'm actually faster off my chest and my lockout's better. So it's a good 1-2 punch. I'm a big fan of close grip benching. You can actually do it on overhead if you normally do your strict pressing kind of wide. Bringing it in closer will give you a similar disadvantaged setup that will cause, you know, new growth. It'll be a novel stimulus in that sense. Narrow squatting and narrow deadlifting, similarly, it'll work with a squat. Your knee more so than your hip, meaning your quads grow more. Similarly with a front squat. With a narrow stance, knee goes through more flexion, that quadricep has to work a little bit harder. So if you have weak quads, taking your stance in a little more narrow, staying a little more upright. Key point for squatting, changing your stance is great. Don't change the bar position. A lot of people get hung up on high bar, low bar, medium bar, whatever. You don't need to change the bar position on your shoulders to change your foot stance or where your hips are going. Yes, generally a high bar position is consistent with kind of a narrow stance and an upright position, and a low bar setup is consistent with a wider stance and a very hip dominant approach. They don't have to go together. I squat low bar, but I stay very upright because of my build. Eric King's just the opposite. He has a bar directly on top of his traps, but he usually squats very wide. His hips track back quite a bit. It's what you're used to. It's what you're comfortable with. Stop fucking around with where the bar goes. Play with your feet. Play with where your knees are going, where your hips are going. Just put the bar where it's comfortable. Narrow deads will pay off. I mean, I've been doing narrow work my entire life on pretty much everything. Narrow squatting, narrow benching, and I deadlift very narrowly. If you're a Brian Shaw type deadlifter or if you're a sumo deadlifter, narrow deads will change the stimulus. Your hips will be back a little more, so you'll have to brace harder through your midsection. Your hip extension will have to improve. You'll probably feel a different stimulus in your quads as far as leg drive goes. So you're talking about rounding out your physique. So this brings us to wide grip work or wide stance work. And this is what I've been focusing on because it's so different than what I normally do. And this is where I've been getting a lot of benefits. When I do bench, because historically I've had trouble getting my pecs to grow, especially with kind of a high arch, narrow, very tucked press. And a lot of you that are really drilling your competitive bench into the ground are tweaking it in a way that gives you a mechanical advantage, but that takes away the developmental capacity. So going wider grip on your bench, just still trying to abide by a setup that's nice on your shoulders. So finding the right amount of tuck. I don't recommend going super flared, but something like middle finger, ring finger on the ring. You might even go, you know, West Side prescribes illegally wide benching sometimes where you're a few inches outside of the ring. That will disadvantage the proximal joint, the joint that's closer to you, so your shoulder instead of your elbow. So that has to go through more movement, meaning your pec has to work harder. You can do those for like medium heavy reps. I've done like a 5x15 for a few weeks and my pecs exploded. And then after that, it felt like I was benching to a cloud. So I'm a big fan of wide work, so long as it does not tear up your joints and your joints can handle it. Now, wide squatting and sumo deadlifting, I've also been incorporating, and I'm a big fan. I'm gonna be doing a lot of these. I said before I hate sumo deadlift, I still hate it as a feat of strength. And many of you are gonna see this video I'm about to put up. I don't even know if you can call it a sumo deadlift. It's more of just a wide stance, stiff leg deadlift. But I've been doing a lot more wide stance deadlifts just because for so many years, I've had my feet in close and going out wider, it exposes my adductors. It exposes my hamstrings. I feel my hamstrings working in a way that I've never felt before. My glutes have to pull from a different angle. Just top to bottom, I have to brace differently. Top to bottom, this is hitting a lot of corners that I know have been getting neglected by just doing the same conventional deadlift. I still believe conventional is better as a standalone developer, but now I'm trying to pad myself. I'm trying to hit different angles, get a little more variety, keep stagnation from setting in. So far, I've been doing these for about 3 or 4 weeks. I'm moving more weight, they don't feel easier. And these are not, by any stretch of the imagination, going to be very technically dialed in. That's not even my goal. I'm not going to be a competitive sumo deadlifter. I don't need this efficient. I just need the work to be able to grow the way that I need to grow. Now, everybody is mechanically advantaged in a sumo deadlift. Doesn't matter how you're built or how you pull. Hips are closer to the bar, range of motion shorter. Leverages, mechanics, they're just better. I've done 10,000 conventional deadlift reps for every one sumo rep because I've never pulled sumo. So the lack in strength, it's not from a strength deficit. Well, in a sense, it's a strength deficit. It's from lack of coordination and lack of work on that specific movement. But I know that because I do have such good mechanical potential to increase, this shows that the weakness I have on sumo, if I bring that up, that's going to represent a new stimulus that I'm not used to, and that's going to spur growth. So I know I have a lot of room to improve, and I anticipate that should carry over to my deadlift pretty well. So I'm excited to see how that goes. Wide stance, squatting, I've also started doing. My hips are very tight, hamstrings and adductors are tight. Wide stance is very uncomfortable, and I have kind of short legs. But I've been switching to that mainly because of patellar tendonitis that's been lingering, keeping my knees back, sinking my hips way back and getting a little more forward. All of that is just all around my hips, hamstrings, into my groin. I feel my glutes a little more. My rectors have to pull in a little different way or to, you know, just to stay tight through the midsection. But I did a lot of volume on these the other day. I was testing this out. I can't really get depth. I'm working on getting a little better depth. This is as low as I could go without having to sacrifice positioning in my lumbar spine. And I was just doing very slow, controlled pauses, focusing on speed on the way up and getting comfortable at the bottom. And this is relatively lightweight for me. I mean, my best squat is in the high sixes. This was not that difficult, but it was very difficult, if that makes sense. So just focusing on control, speed, positioning, this is a way I made very lightweight work for me, which is a valuable tool to have. You wanna know how to make lighter weight work for you. And this is a way I did that just by changing my stance. So now I don't have to handle as much load, but I'm still getting a huge growth effect. And I was sore. I had to do events the day after this. and I was so sore and I'm still beat up from it. This was a rough workout. And that's only going up to like something that's about 70% of a one rep max. So that tells you how much leeway you have to play with things and kind of find different ways of moving without just having to add more weight, add more weight, add more weight. And you'll go back through old programs from the 70s. There's a ton of templates. Guys like Doug Young and Bill Kazmaier and many others, you'll see that a lot of their work was barbell work with some grip variation. And that was about it. And they would run through all of those for a certain amount of volume, progress linearly, and they got stronger. So before you think about just throwing in a bunch of weird, odd accessories, throw in some basic, simple changes, progress them for 4 or 5 weeks, see how you feel as you adapt to it, and see what that has to offer your main lift. And you'll be very surprised. It'll be a much more straightforward and simple way to spur growth when things get stagnant. So that's all I got for you for today. Go ahead and leave questions, comments. I'm sure there'll be a lot of them in the comments box. Go ahead and take it to the forum, empire-forum.com. I'll answer questions there as well. Until next time, guys, this is Bromley from Empire Barbell. I'll see you.